Between 1941 and 1945, the Nazis systematically killed approximately 6 million Jews across Germany-occupied Europe. Pogroms and mass shootings took place in cities and towns across the continent. Eventually, the Nazis developed a policy of extermination through labour in concentration camps and in gas chambers and gas vans in German extermination camps. This memorial, opened to the public in 2005, covers an area of 19,000 square metres and is covered with 2,711 concrete slabs. The numbers hold no symbolic significance. Its creator, Peter Eisenman, wanting to create an uneasy, confusing atmosphere, suggested that the site is meant to resemble a cemetery, perhaps for those who were buried in unmarked mass graves. It is very disorientating when you're walking around in here. It's easy to get lost. There is an actual museum in this place, underneath this, which I might go and have a look at. I think it's free. I have been in there before and it was really good. So I'm just going to wander around here for a while. I'm going to turn the camera off, wander around, and yeah, see if I can find this museum. Two things that really kind of grab you, or the things that really got to me was the sheer scale of it, the numbers. You know, you hear about some, you know, some pogroms and then some mass killings in various towns across Europe, and it tells you how many people were killed in just a few, a matter of weeks, and there's thousands of them, sometimes hundreds of thousands. And you just can't get your head around numbers that big, especially when it's, you know, relating to lives. And maybe that's part of what this memorial is all about. Just the scale of it. The other thing that really kind of got to me was when you take them numbers away and it focuses on individual stories. And so there was one part where it's all letters that people had written when during the Holocaust. Some of the people were killed, and it's the personal experience, it's the personal side of it which really, really gets to you. When you think, you know, 6 million Jews were murdered in the Holocaust, and every single one of them people were, you know, someone's son or daughter, or maybe a sister, a mother, a father, grandfather, child, and they all had their own stories. And some of the letters, I mean, some of them were messages written on the spines of books because there was no paper to write anything on. Some of them were written on toilet paper and then thrown out of carriages as they were being taken to Auschwitz or some other camp. Some of the people survived, not many. Some of the people, obviously, most of the people didn't. And the one that really got to me was where it was a guy who threw a letter out of the train that was taking him to Auschwitz. And there was no more information about him. No one knows what happened to him. So this is the oldest Jewish cemetery in Berlin, and the first 50 residents, Jewish residents that came to Berlin, set up this cemetery, which had approximately 3,000 graves until it closed in 1827, and then the Nazis destroyed it and turned it into air raid shelters, and they used the gravestones to build the walls. And then at the end of the war, it was used as a mass grave for soldiers and civilians. 10,000 people were buried here, and the Nazis used this, once they destroyed the cemetery, they used it as a sports area, place to kind of train. And the buildings that surrounded it, there used to be a Jewish care home, and they just basically emptied that because they wanted to use it as a prison reception area. And a lot of the buildings were just turned into prisons. So the people that lived in them were basically told they had to leave or put sent to camps and killed. And the Nazis just took over the building and used it for whatever purpose they seemed to fit. So it's not a very green area. There's no stones or anything. All the stones, as I say, were destroyed. And the ones that were left, I think there were 15 stones left. They've now been removed because they were getting damaged by the weather. So now it's just a nice little green area in Berlin. So keep your eyes open for this little alleyway here, because there's a couple of things, apart from all the amazing street art and the lovely cafes, there's a couple of things that you might want to check out. The first one is this, the museum at Blindenwerkstatt Otto Weidt. And Otto was the owner of a small factory that produced brooms and brushes. And during the war, he employed mainly blind and deaf Jews. And he went to great efforts to protect them from persecution, and found places for them to hide. And one of the places where they hid was the museum. It's in here somewhere, and it's free admission as well. So I'm going to go and check that out. It is open in a couple of minutes. And the second place is the All About Anne Frank. Museum. Now, Anne Frank doesn't really need an introduction, being as she is probably the most famous victim of the Holocaust. So this is a memorial to honour the homosexual victims of the Holocaust. And I do believe you just come around here, there should be video playing. Yeah, there we go. I don't know if you can see that. You should be able to. So I think that's two men. It just changed. Oh, there we go. And then we've got the two women kissing as well. In 1935, Nazis ordered the criminalisation of male homosexuality. Just a kiss could lead to prosecution. There were over 50,000 convicts, and many were ordered to be castrated. Several thousand gays were sent to concentration camps and ordered to wear a pink triangle to display their sexuality, and most did not survive. For a long time, the homosexual victims of National Socialism were excluded from the commemorative culture of both post-war German states, where gays were continued to be prosecuted for decades. Gay victims of Nazism were not officially recognised in the immediate aftermath of the Third Reich. It wasn't until the 1980s that these forgotten victims were discussed. Well, this is a memorial for the victims of the Nazi euthanasia programme. And actually, this building, part of this building there, that was the location of the headquarters for the National Socialist mass murder of people with mental disabilities or illnesses. So there used to be a villa here, and that's where they used to murder people people were disabled. 1933, the National Socialist regime issued a law for the prevention of genetically diseased offspring. Basically forced sterilization. A survey showed that nearly three quarters of people who were asked agreed to the painless shortening of their child's life. Again, it's the numbers. This centre, which was called the Action T4, was the administration centre for all the killing centres around Germany and Poland. 70,000 people were gassed in killing centres, and a further 20,000 from concentration camps. Doctors and nurses killed 90,000 people through deliberate neglect, starvation, and drugs. Doctors and nurses. And this is here, this is the T4. This is one of the buses that they used. Set up a fake company called the Charitable Ambulance Services to take patients to the killing centres set up for the murder of patients. And these were the killing centres that the patients were sent to. Well, that's worth coming to check out. There's a lot of good information on there. Unfortunately, the videos are only in German, so they weren't much use to me. But yeah, it's a part of the Holocaust that maybe even today still gets overlooked. But when you see the numbers, literally hundreds of thousands of people were murdered in killing centres, just because you know, they had a disability or an illness. And right here was the heart of it all. This used to be the T4 Action Centre, and it was the administration centre for the euthanasia of physically and mentally disabled people. And it gives you examples of the kind of propaganda that the Nazis were using, which was so strong, and people bought into it so much that even parents were willing to let their children be killed because they had, you know, a mental illness. They thought they were doing the right thing by them. And it's quite incredible that people's mindsets can be changed so much by some of the propaganda. The information does it is on kind of on a time scale, and it does go right up to post-war and people's attitudes towards mentally ill people and how it changed. And quite worryingly, it didn't change that much for many, many years. It was only relatively recently where people who were killed as part of the euthanasia program were actually classified as Holocaust victims. Many people didn't receive any compensation because they weren't classified as victims of the Holocaust, which is quite incredible. And to think that doctors and nurses were killing people by either starving them or using drugs or neglect. So if you come just away from the Brandenburg Gate and enter the Tierpark, I think this is, just on your right hand side you have the memorial to the Roma and Sinti gypsies. And as you walk in, it's got a timeline of persecution that they faced under the Nazis. Starts in 1933. Intense discrimination, deprived of their rights and excluded from society. And the first Sinti and Roma are interned in concentration camps. Forced sterilization follows in 1934. 1935, just before the Olympic Games in Berlin. Hundreds of people interned in a camp. 1936, the Nuremberg Laws decreed that alien races in Europe apply to Jews and Gypsies. 1938, 2,000 Sinti and Roma, including children aged 12 and over, are taken to Dachau, Buchenwald, Sachsenhausen, Ravensbrück, Mauthausen and other camps. Himmler issues a basic decree to tackle the Gypsy question on basis of race, with the aim of finding a final solution. Deportation began in 1939. In 1940, the first transports of Gypsies moving out to camps and required to carry special ID papers bearing the letter Z, which stands for Ziguna, which is German for Gypsy. Mm. 1941, systematic mass shooting of Roma starts in the Soviet Union and other occupied territories. 1942, Joseph Goebbels. Jews and Gypsies as such are to be exterminated. The idea of extermination by work is best. 1942, 23,000 Gypsies from throughout Europe are sent to Auschwitz. Within a few months, most die of hunger, disease. 1944, with 6,000 prisoners that were still alive in the Gypsy camp at Auschwitz, resist their murder. Around half of them are deported to other camps. The remaining 3,000 survivors, mostly children, women and elderly, are murdered in the gas chambers on the night of the 2nd of August. By the war's end, in 1945, as many as 500,000 men, women and children who were persecuted as Gypsies have become victims of the genocide. Got words around the edges, I'm not sure what they are though. Don't recognise them. Some of the stones I recognise because these are the places where they would have been sent. So we've got Treblinka, Buchenwald, Mauthausen, and three Auschwitz is here somewhere. So the next stop on the Berlin Holocaust tour is the German Resistance Memorial Centre. So this courtyard is where resistance fighters were executed. In 1942, government officials, SS and Nazis met in the Wannsee mansion to discuss the deportation and extermination of all of Europe's Jews. There was to be no discussion about if it was to take place, just on how it would take place. It was here, in this beautiful mansion overlooking the lake, where it was decided that a number of extermination camps would be built big enough to kill all of Europe's Jews. This is where the conference took place to discuss the final solution to the Jewish problem. So this is Anhalter Bahnhof, where from 1942 to 1945, almost 10,000 Jews were sent from here to Terezin in Czechoslovakia. And they were sent on ordinary trains that run to normal timetables. And Hitler did plan to turn this building into a public swimming pool, but it was almost entirely destroyed by three air raids towards the end of the war. It's beautiful. I love how stuff like this is just left as a reminder. It's just the front of the building that's left. Let's go and have a look, see if we can find some information. So just behind the entrance to the station, there's all these information boards. This one here, people's memories. Once a week, every Tuesday, the trains left Anhalter Bahnhof with Jewish children and young adults. The platform was called Platform of Tears. So Shimon Sexer emigrated to Palestine in 1939. He never saw his parents again. My parents sat on their bench like two sculptures. They sat motionless and stared out into space. We would never see one another again. My mother brought me to the train. I was so excited that I ran up the stairs without even saying goodbye. She called me back, we hugged and kissed, and that was the last time I saw her. Yeah, it looks like they're building a new museum. And this is what it'll look like. When you think of the amount of people that have come to this station to get on a train that had a timetable and had to show their ticket to take a train to a concentration camp. See the all this Berlin Wall, which was this part of it was left here as requested by the museum. The Topography of Terror, which is where I am now. So I've just been inside the museum. I didn't really spend too much time in there because there's so much information, so much to read. It would literally take the whole day, and I have been in there before. It's a great museum. It's free admission as well. So if that period of history interests you, then obviously pay a visit. Now this bit, as you go out, this basically is a timeline of Berlin from 1933 to 1945. But I can remember thinking how well they'd done it, kind of linking events of the past to as a warning to what could happen in the present or the future. Back then it was 2014, and in England we had like kind of groups like the English Defence League and the British National Party. Kind of thought, you know, groups like the EDL, they're never going to come into any real power, but then people thought that about the Nazis. This explains how the worldwide economic crisis of the late 20s really hit Germany hard. They were still suffering from the financial after effects of World War I, and people started losing trust in mainstream politicians and started turning to the extreme Nazi party, who won seats on the council for the first time. Approximately 50,000 Jewish people would have made their final journey from this old station. Daily trains would take them to various concentration camps, where the vast majority of them would have died. just imagine the horror that would have taken place just right here. The people were forced to leave their lives, leave their possessions, leave their families to make this journey. And most people wouldn't have had any idea what they were about to face. Many people were told that they would be safer in the camps. They would be looked after. They would be given food. They would have work. And of course, it was all a lie. The vast majority of them would have been either worked to death. Or sent to the gas chambers. So we've got 1941, 1,251 Jews from Berlin were sent to Łódź, which is the ghetto in Poland. Again, another 896 to Łódź. All of these, another 1,000. 24th of October, 27th of October, the 1st of November, 14th of November, 17th of November. But the numbers are quite big, and as you walk around, I mean, we've gone now, we've got people sent to Minsk, to Kovno, to Riga, Lublin. That would have been Manthausen, I think. Warsaw, don't know if that means Warsaw. And then they really started to pick up, it looked like from here. They were pretty much almost daily. So, and these were trains that went to Theresienstadt, which I'm definitely pronouncing wrong. It's in the Czech Republic, north of Prague. So you got 100 Jews sent on the 2nd, 100 more on the 4th, 50 on the 5th, another 50 on the 9th. And then some 746 sent to Unbekannt. Not sure where that is. Terrorism. Unbekannt, Terrorism. Becomes a little more systematic now. Literally every day, 26th of August, 100 Jews sent to Terezin, 27th, 100 sent to Terezin, 28, 100 sent to Terezin. And on the 29th of November, 1942, the first train to depart from here that took 1,000 Jews from Berlin to Auschwitz. Another 1,000 to Auschwitz. You can see the difference in the numbers. So the trains going to Auschwitz would take 1,190 Jews. The ones going to Terezin pretty much seems to be 100 each time. Auschwitz was obviously much bigger than Terezin, and therefore could accommodate more Jews. A thousand to Auschwitz, 1,736, 1,758. We're in 1943 now, the numbers are just going up. Can you imagine 2,000 people all crowded into this small space? Most of them wouldn't have known where they were heading. And obviously Auschwitz didn't have the negative connotations what it does now. People didn't know what Auschwitz was. The numbers are starting to get less now. We've got 55 Jews being sent to Auschwitz, 48 to Auschwitz. Maybe it's because by the time we start and get into like 1944, there weren't actually that many left. 30 to Auschwitz compared to nearly 2,000 to the last train to leave here. was on the 27th of March, and it took 18 Jews to terrorism.